The Edmonton Oilers hired Ken Holland and people are screaming. A lot of them Oilers fans, and some of them being accused of being poisonous. Meanwhile, Edmonton Oilers fans have every right to complain. They have Connor McDavid, Leon Draisaitl, and look. You ever watch Kitchen Nightmares? Everyone telling Oilers fans to just calm down are like the delusional restaurant owners that yell at Gordon Ramsay.
Well, I think her lasagna's wonderful.
There's a toe in it, you idiot! A human toe! I don't think Edmonton Oilers fans are poisonous, I just think they're freaking out about everything because they have every right to. So knowing that, I'm gonna try to give a level-headed approach to this move. Listen. For most fan bases, this is a dangerous time of year. There's a handful of fan bases that are stressed out right now because their teams are still playing hockey games, and we're all jealous of those stressed out fans. We want that stress in our lives. For everybody else whose team is out of it, all you have is time and your imagination, which is dangerous. I look at the Oilers signing Ken Holland, and it's a perfect example of that. He's gonna do this, he won't do that. The truth is, we just don't know. We're guessing. So with Ken Holland going to Edmonton, what do they got? The pros seem obvious. He was the GM in Detroit for a very long time, and funny enough, the Detroit Red Wings were good for a really long time. They won Stanley Cups and everything. A lot of people are pointing out that Ken Holland's recent track record as GM isn't very good, but even the best GMs in NHL history, they don't go undefeated. They don't go without a mistake in their whole career. He helped build a winning culture in Detroit and sustain that winning culture in Detroit for a very long time. Why wouldn't the Edmonton Oilers want this guy? And that question is answered easily by the cons, which are, oh my goodness, look at Detroit's cap situation. He wasn't able to fix the Red Wings cap situation. How the heck is he gonna fix the Oilers? They need to dump cap and get some good young guys through the draft, and he drafted a bunch of good guys, but that was a long time ago and he sort of rode that for a while. So everyone's saying that Ken Holland is gonna resurrect the Oilers because he's a winning winner who wins everything. They're guessing. And everyone's saying he's gonna make things worse in Edmonton and he's gonna put them further into cap hell and he doesn't know what he's doing. You're also guessing. So let's stop guessing. Let's look at some things that actually happened. I've seen a lot of people compare the Ken Holland signing in Edmonton to the Lou Lamoriello signing in Toronto, which is gonna make a lot of people nauseous, but shut up and listen, as well as the Lou Lamoriello signing in Long Island, or Brooklyn, wherever they play. What Lou Lamoriello has done with the Islanders is obvious. He came in there and, oh my goodness, instant playoffs after everybody thought they were done. With the Leafs, it was different. And maybe a bit more familiar. We're talking a decade plus of mediocrity, and worse than mediocrity. The Leafs of a few years ago would have prayed for mediocrity. Blue and white disease, nobody trying, everybody leaving, nobody wants to be a Leaf. Lou Lamoriello comes in, and first of all, he was hired as Leafs GM before I knew he stepped down as Oilers GM. It was just this whirlwind that came out of nowhere. And with him, he immediately brought this air of respect, and he started changing some things around the organization. People talk about him making guys cut their hair and shave their face, you know, to a established professionalism and all that. That was just the silly stuff. What I remember is Lou Lamoriello's first trade as Leafs GM was trading 5 guys on picture day. Lou was not there to mess around. There were guys, they, oh yeah, I'm a Leaf now, and they get their picture taken and they were traded half an hour later. And not everyone was sure about what he brought to the table. Like, yeah, I know he's got a winning track record, but he's got this really old, stubborn mind and And what he did with the Leafs was not universally beloved, but it cannot be argued that he helped establish a new culture around the team. Anything less than professional, anything less than 100% would not be tolerated. I want to go through some things that I've heard said and what I think about them. One being that Ken Holland left the Detroit Red Wings in terrible shape. Well, I don't know about that. Okay, for sure they're not good, and they haven't been for a few years, so yeah. But I think there's a difference between your team's not good and they're in bad shape. Detroit's not good, but I think they're in okay shape. Because even though the team by and large isn't good, their best players are young. If you're gonna have a bad team, at least have your best players be young. And you can look at Detroit and the cap situation and go, what are you talking about? The Nielsen contract, the Abdelkader contract, 3 Detroit defensemen signed to next year are 35 or older. That's true, very true. And that's bad, but to me, those are the sins of the past. That happened a while ago, and they're paying for it, but it happened a while ago. But the future is with Dylan Larkin, Anthony Mantha, Tyler Bertuzzi, Andreas Athanasiou. They're young guys. They got Philip Zadina coming. They got another high draft pick, and there's also other guys that they have in the minors. If I'm an Oilers fan, the encouraging part is the Red Wings are a team of the future. Just maybe not right now. Here's what sucks for the Oilers. Detroit is rebuilding. The Oilers aren't really rebuilding. Like, we know tanking's a thing. The bad teams in the NHL that mean to be bad are in a good position. It's the teams who think they're good and end up sucking that are in trouble, and that would describe the Oilers. Yes, Ken Holland added some decent, talented young players to Detroit, but what he's got to do is remove the cap hell that is restricting the Oilers right now, and he wasn't really able to do that in Detroit. That, I think, is a huge red flag. But what's amazing to me is if he can do it, honestly, if the Oilers can get out from under, like, a couple contracts, doesn't matter who it is, I think they're not far away from being a contender. And you raise your eyebrows and you go, the Edmonton, really? Any team with Connor McDavid, and I'll throw 50 goal scorer Leon Draisaitl in there, should be a contender. Oilers had some success with Alex Chiasson this year. If you hit on a few cheap free agents, you're gold. Yeah, but you still need stops, and Mikko Koskinen wasn't very good this year. And that's not a problem you can fix overnight. Are you sure? Because the Carolina Hurricanes and New York Islanders both fixed that problem overnight. A tandem of Peter Mrazek and Curtis McElhinney is currently in the NHL's Final Four. Did you predict that in September? Robin Lehner was nominated for the Vezina Trophy, and lost in all that is Thomas Greiss, who was awful last season, was spectacular this one. Like, the salary cap's been around for a while. Don't say something can't be done when lots of teams have done it. Which brings us to the whole conversation, the most stressful point. Is Ken Holland that guy? Is he that miracle worker? I don't know, and I don't think you do either. We're all just guessing. Yeah, he's a bit of an older hockey mind. He's an established name, and that's the problem. I think we know that the Oilers management group, the ownership group, likes brand names. They could have brought in this younger guy, this creative guy, this unconventional type with all these wacky ideas. I just don't think they would have been listened to. Can you just boss around Ken Holland? And people are going to say, well, Pete Chiarelli had Stanley Cup winning experience. No. One. Not diminishing it, but one. Lots of general managers have won one. This is Ken Holland. There's been all sorts of stories out there of people high up in the Edmonton Oilers organization sticking their nose in business where maybe they shouldn't oughta. I don't think you can do that with Ken Holland. And I think he's got an opinion that they respect, so maybe they will butt out. I know the maybe's not comfortable, but when you think about it, everything's a maybe. Just my personal theory, I think what Ken Holland is going to do first is try to fix the Oilers from the front office down. The real fun with fixing the on-ice product, it's over a month away at the draft. He's got to take a good look at how things are run, and if he doesn't like anything, it's got to go. And when he gets a better idea when the season begins, September, October, November, if he doesn't like what he sees, they got to go. Because it's not like he's the only decision maker, right? If he can establish a better way of running things within the organization, and make sure that the people around him are making smarter decisions, all of a sudden, the Oilers will look like a team making smarter decisions. Which usually, sometimes a little slowly, sometimes quickly, results in a better team. And I'll stand by this. If you have Connor McDavid on your team, I don't even know if you gotta be that good. You still might win. The cap crunch, the culture, it's not gonna be easy. But this idea that Ken Holland can't do it because he's old and forgot how to GM, I'm just not convinced. Maybe, just maybe, he can be the antidote to the poison. That is it for this one. Thank you very much for watching. Click like if you like this video. Click subscribe if you really liked it. Tell all your friends. Leave a comment down below. Oh boy, he's got a job ahead of him.